The details still, of course, to be revealed a bit later today, but what is your expectation, particularly regarding possible changes to visa rules to allow more Aussies to work in the UK and vice versa? That's something I know a lot of our viewers might be particularly interested in.
Hi, Ash. Thanks for having me on. Yeah, look, mobility is certainly one of the key aspects that we're hoping to see really enhanced in the FTA, and if not directly through the FTA, then through a bilateral agreement alongside it. We know that trade and services accounts for a large portion of both our economies, you know, somewhere around the 80% mark, and therefore is a key part of services is the movement of people to deliver the IP and knowledge to make those businesses go in different markets. So really keen to see what they've done there. I think the trading goods side is of less importance overall, but obviously very important, particularly in agriculture. And I know that's been a key stumbling block, so it'll be very interesting to see where we've wound up on that front.
Because that is particularly significant, isn't it, that part of the deal as we try to recover from China's decision to place tariffs or have outright bans on a number of products. We've really seen a lot of our exporters here in limbo, and that sort of security of this deal being inked with the UK is something that a lot of exporters have been really looking forward to seeing the fine print on.
Yeah, that's right. And look, the finest of the fine print won't actually come out tonight. This is really the agreement in principle. It's a heads of agreement, if you like, to put it in business parlance. It will give us the general shape of what will be what's been agreed at the top level. There will be finer details to be worked out in terms of the finer print and the text of the agreement, and that will happen over the next few months, I'm sure. But we should understand the basic shape of the agreement through this process. We're very keen at the Australian British Chamber of Commerce to hear what that detail is and find out how we can best promote our businesses from here in Australia into the UK and attract more investment and opportunities for British companies here in Australia as well through that process. So this is an important milestone. We look forward to seeing the detail later today and hearing the announcement when it comes sometime late afternoon our time here in Sydney.
Yeah, and I know that a lot of people will particularly be looking at what happens to Australian beef and lamb. There have been squabbles on that front as to how much of that would be allowed in the UK and also the time frame of that too, because when it comes to those products, phasing out tariffs and quotas over a particular time period is really going to be something that the agriculture sector is watching closely.
Yeah, look, I think that's right, but I also think it's probably not as big a deal for the Australian industry as perhaps how we paint it normally. The UK is on the other side of the world, and there are lots of great markets for our beef and lamb in particular into Asia and in our local area, and I don't think that we're suddenly going to swamp the UK market with all the Australian beef we produce. In fact, listening to the industry in the last few months, it's been interesting to hear that they're basically not sure that they could really take full advantage of that given the drought conditions and the reduced stock numbers that we've had in Australia over the last few years because of that, to really take advantage of this on day one anyway. I think there will be a gradual increase. I think that whatever the time frame is, as long as the aim and the ambition of zero tariff and zero quota trade in all products between Australia and the UK is met. Obviously, the sooner the better. But as long as that is really held to, then I think we've got a great opportunity to really enhance the trading relationship in goods in both directions.
So, David, from the British angle, is this likely to be viewed as a victory for Boris Johnson? I mean, this, I understand, will be the first deal that the British PM has struck as he continues to work on a number of agreements with other trading partners post-Brexit. What is the view likely to be from the UK?
Yeah, look, absolutely. So the challenge that the UK have had is obviously for the last 40 years, the EU has been responsible for trade policy for the EU, which has obviously included the UK up until their departure last year. So this is really the first new agreement that the UK are signing into. They've rolled other agreements over that they've had with through the EU with countries like Japan. This is the first one that started with a clean sheet of paper that really starts to set their agenda going forward. As Secretary of State Liz Truss has said on numerous occasions, and indeed has been echoed politically here in Australia, you know, we want to see a gold standard FTA between the two countries. We want to see us really pushing forward into a genuine 21st century deal, one that not only covers goods and the traditional trade in services and investment rules, looking at mobility as we've talked about, but also looking at things like the digital economy that in a lot of free trade agreements hasn't really been pushed to the edge. Australia's done some great stuff recently in that space with places like Singapore. We've obviously got a fantastic deal with our nearest neighbours in New Zealand. So really pushing the envelope in this deal to really make it a high quality, gold standard, as I say, deal. And for the UK, this really is a flag-waving opportunity to say independent global Britain is back and they're keen to do trade with all of the world. And as the Prime Minister said in your preview piece there, what better place to do that with than Australia? So we're really pleased to be at the front of the queue.
David McCredie, appreciate your insights. Thank you.
My pleasure.